good.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you all for being here. And as Christian was saying, this is a bit of an update on what we've been doing over the past year. So we were at the EAMS conference last year and had some very helpful input from participants there. So we're now feeding back to you where we're where we've got to with the project. And as Christian said, I've been working with Ian and Chris on leading this project, but really as a big collaborative effort. So I've got all the names coming up of people, and I did see quite a few of them in the participants list. So hello to you all. Okay, so where did this all come from? Our aim here has been to develop a shared research agenda for computer-aided assessment of university mathematics. So that sounds quite specific, quite niche, but actually still surprisingly quite broad. There's a lot of stuff that we don't know there. And maybe just to start off with a story, actually, going back a few years when I was starting off in my job, I had a colleague in the department, and I'll not name them, so I'll use a pseudonym of Alex, but I think Chris will know who I mean when I'm talking about this. So our colleague Alex would be, you know, very thoughtful about their teaching, wanting to use computer-aided assessment and introduce that to their classes, but had a lot of questions for us about how best to do it. So I've got a lot of choices here. Should I do the quizzes weekly or fortnightly? When should I give feedback? How many marks should I give? So lots of very practical questions. And Chris and I, aware of the research that's out there, didn't really have good answers. So that's really, for me, the genesis of this project, is thinking about those very practical questions about how to be effective with computer-aided assessment. Where does the research come in to give you the answers to those very practical questions? So connecting that up to something that I was reading, this kind of distinction has been made in the past. So even going back all the way to Louis Pasteur, the distinction between his theoretical research and his very applied research. So the same sort of situation maps onto mathematics education research. So on the left-hand side there, we have the pure basic research. So really pure mathematics education researchers, essentially just interested in understanding how people learn mathematics. Whereas on the right-hand side, we've got practical university teachers, and they're interested in getting their students to learn some mathematics. But their concerns are very practical. And what they're maybe concerned with is taking their existing teaching materials and approaches to teaching and making those better, making them improved. So the suggestion here is that there's something to be learned in the crossover. So what's being called for is this program of use-inspired basic research. So the researchers on the left-hand side are able to answer questions that they're interested in about how people learn mathematics, through being informed by the practical concerns of the teachers on the right-hand side. And vice versa, the practical teachers on the right-hand side get the insights from the research, and that helps to improve their practice. So we think there really is something to be gained in working together. And that really informed the approach that we took to this collaborative project, to bring together people with different sets of expertise, so that we could benefit from that kind of cross-fertilization. So we were modeling this on previous exercises. So this kind of thing has been done in the past. And on the right-hand side, there's an example of one of the outcomes of that. So this was a big project in mathematical cognition, which brought together a lot of researchers working in that field at the time. That itself was modeled on previous exercises, which were to do with ecology and earth sciences. And the idea of those projects, again, is to bring together experts who all have a stake in these questions and an interest in them, and to try and bring it all together. So what is the state of the set of questions that people have about this topic? And maybe trying to prioritize them as well. So we were inspired by that model, but in some ways we had we had to vary it to suit our particular aims. And I mentioned that we had a big group of participants. So this is everyone who participated some questions into the project. And yeah, many of them are here today as well. So big thank you to you all. This wouldn't have happened without everyone kind of pulling together and contributing their ideas. And I suppose also one other thing is the fact that we were doing this online over the past year has meant that we were able to go maybe a bit further afield than we would have been able to otherwise. So Igor in particular in Auckland has been a champion coming to some of our meetings at rather unfavorable times for him. So this is kind of what we've been up to over the past year. I'm going to kind of step you through the process that we went through, and then I'll be able to tell you about some of the results that we've got so far. So we started off with an online form where all these participants were invited to submit the questions that they thought would be part of this agenda. And then we had a working group meeting. So everyone in the working group got together back in May last year. That was a Zoom meeting online. What we did in that meeting is we broke into smaller groups and discussed the questions a bit more closely. And the aim in that session really was to refine the wording, make sure that everyone was understanding what the original proposer had meant by that question. And that really, you know, spurred a lot of interesting discussion. It was clear at that time that particularly with everyone shifting their teaching online over the past year, at that point, there was a lot of questions about the implications of all this. So there were definitely some useful discussions to be had even at that point about kind of what were the key questions that were emerging out of this big shift. So after that meeting, we formed some loose categories. So we had 50, 60 questions by that point, and it was, you know, rather unwieldy to get through all of those. So we grouped them into five loose categories so that we could take them to different conferences and show them to people and have some kind of loose organization that would make it a bit easier to digest the set of questions. So as I said, we took those to various conferences over the summer. EAMS was one of them. We would give a little presentation, kind of like I've been doing now, about what we're doing, and share some of the questions. And that was also a chance to hear back from the participants in these different conferences. So I think we were particularly interested there of what have we missed? And do these seem like a kind of plausible set of questions about this domain? And a nice thing about the fact, again, that a lot of this was happening online is that we were able to reach out reasonably widely. So the MEDA conference there was a European one. And NE Room, so that's the Northeastern Research and Undergraduate Maths Education Conference. So we wouldn't ordinarily have gone to New Jersey for a weekend to present about this, but we were able to do a session there. And I think this has all been really quite useful, particularly actually EAMS last year. We had some really good discussions with small groups. And out of that, we were getting some suggestions for things that we'd missed. So it was very worthwhile to have done that. And we took those new questions, rather than going back through the whole, you know, we could essentially iterate this whole process a million times and never get anywhere. So we had to, at some points, just be a little bit dictatorial between me, Chris, and Ian, and just, you know, push things on a bit. So for these new questions that came in, we essentially took an executive decision there, vetted which ones we thought were did some of the process of refining wording as needed as well. So we did incorporate a few new questions out of that process. And back in January this year, we went back to the whole working group, sort of explained where we'd got to by this point. Here are the set of questions that we now have. And again, got into smaller groups to discuss the questions in a bit more detail. Now, our two aims at that meeting were, so first of all, discussing questions of interest. So we were really hoping that as part of this process, getting people together, it would spur people on to answer some of these questions. So actually at that meeting, some of the focus shifted to, you know, what questions are you interested in doing some work on? let's maybe make some plans. And the second part of it was we decided that there's so much context that's needed sometimes to understand these questions. And actually we'd gathered a lot of really useful insight into these questions that we wanted to capture and not lose. And there just wasn't space to do that justice in the manuscript that we're going to be writing about this. So we wanted to capture all the detail. And so we've came up with this idea of having a website where for each question, there will be details about that question. And I'll show you an example of that towards the end. So during that meeting, we were really switching to thinking about, as a group, editing the content of that website and making it ready to go. So that's where we got to at the start of the year, and people from the working group have been tinkering away, editing the content there. And simultaneously, together with Chris and Ian, I've been working on preparing the kind of final manuscript that tells this whole story. That will be written primarily by the three of us, but then shared with the working group for comments, and we'll all be sharing authorship on that manuscript. So we'll have those two main outputs, the manuscript itself, which gives a summary, but also this website, which will be a supplement that has a lot more detail than we could include in a single article. So those are the two main sort of outputs, but also we're hoping a big output of all this is going to be answers. So that was kind of the whole idea of having this project, was to identify these questions where we need some answers, and hopefully to spur a program of research into getting those answers. So what are the questions about? Those discussions we're going to feed into getting those answers, hopefully. So the questions themselves, we lost faith in the themes that we came up with, those loose groupings. So at EAMS last year, we had five groups of questions, but the more and more we talked about them at the different conferences, the less some of them made sense. So we went back to the drawing board and came up with new ways of categorizing the questions. Again, this is mainly a sort of organizational thing, so that in the manuscript we're able to present some sensible groups of related questions. So don't maybe necessarily read too much into these. We're not trying to define the lay of the land in terms of research. But here's the themes that we've come up with now. And I'll go through each of these in turn and just give a flavour of the sort of questions that they're concerned with. And of course, they're not entirely distinct. There's a lot of overlap in some of the concerns of these as well. So to start with, errors and feedback. So this was really, even going right back to the start, this was a clear, strong theme. And it may just be down to the interests of the group that we've got, but it seems that it is it's a strong concern in maths education and in e-assessment is, first of all, what sorts of errors do students make? So kind of mathematical errors, perhaps errors to do with the fact that it's e-assessment rather than writing on paper. And then how do you optimize the feedback for those errors? So that includes all sorts of things to do with timing, but also the content of the feedback. And related to that, there's an interesting group of questions emerging, not just about the content of the feedback or the timing, but a sort of process of giving feedback that might be more like a human teacher would do. So are there things that we can learn from the way that classroom teachers would respond to a student making an error and sort of emulate that approach using e-assessment of trying to be perhaps a little bit less helpful all the time? So rather than have a full model solution, we might give a hint. So then the second theme is to do with students. And of course, arguably all the questions ultimately are to do with students because it's about e-assessment and that has to involve the student somehow. But these questions really were particularly focused on the student response. So questions like, how do students actually interact with e-assessment systems? I think that was one of the questions that, to each of the questions we asked, contributors to put their name next to it if they were sort of interested in that question. And this was one that got some of the most interest out of the group, actually. It's I guess because the students go off and do their e-assessments often unsupervised. It's a bit of a black box and we don't really know what they're doing when they're clicking around. And the sort of approaches that they use mathematically to solve things, you know, do they work on paper and then type their answers in? All these kind of things. We're sort of interested in the way that the students approach the tasks. And then following that, when we give them feedback, how do they engage with the feedback? It's all the previous questions about optimizing things only really make sense if the students are actually attending to the feedback. So how do they take it on board? Do they, and what do they do with it? And then also some questions about students working together. So often we're thinking about students using e-assessment as a very individual thing where they're working on improving their skills. But there are some cases where we want students to be working together. And yeah, there are some questions here about how e-assessment can be used to support that. And then I think this other question about what are students' views about all of this was another one that the group was particularly interested in. So that, I think, cuts across a lot of the other questions about ultimately you could ask for something that you're trying in your teaching, what are students' views about it? And I think here it's a question of maybe comparing e-assessment to other approaches and what are the particular things about e-assessment that students find useful or not so useful? And these can all inform future developments. Moving on to the third theme of design and implementation. So this is thinking more about the role that we have as assessment designers or teachers. So the first kind of group of questions are about the principles that we use to do this work. So what principles exist? What guidelines and different recommendations are there for how to go about the process of designing effective e-assessment tasks? So that's kind of one side of it, what is out there. And then the other side is a bit more evaluative and what should be used. So I guess that's looking for some evidence of effectiveness and what are the principles that are really the most helpful ones to be using. And then taking a sort of step back aside from the actually designing the tasks, this maybe comes back to my Alex problem of, I've got the lecturer who wants to know how to design their course and how to embed e-assessment in it effectively. So what guidance for lecturers is there and how effective is it in helping them design effective courses that use e-assessment? And also within this category are some more specific questions. So there's one here about the effects of randomization. So there are actually a few questions on that theme. It's quite a powerful feature in mathematics e-assessment that we can randomize the questions and range over spaces of similar questions. And that has certain implications. So there are various questions about those different implications of being able to randomize questions. And moving on to the fourth theme about affordances. So this is, you know, what kinds of things can e-assessment do, broadly speaking? So there are some questions about what kinds of things can we assess? And again, that comes back to maybe my Alex problem of a lecturer who wants to be able to assess certain things in their course. There are certain mathematical skills that they want students to develop. Can we get e-assessment to do that? So using current tools, what kinds of mathematical skills can we assess? And that's something that's been very topical over the past year, as maybe some of the other ways that we might want to be assessing have been unavailable to us. So the tools that we currently have, what kinds of things can we actually assess with them? And again, coming back to that kind of topical issue, I think this has been particularly pressing over the past year, dealing with students' free form input. So I think this was certainly would have been on the agenda if we'd started this a bit earlier, but it was definitely there a bit more strongly, given that we were doing this over the past year. So how can we integrate students' handwritten responses or other kinds of input like graph sketching, which might be done electronically. How can we capture all those things and assess them beyond just a typed final answer? And there's questions there. It relates to questions about how students perform in those different media. So is there a difference in their performance if they are able to write something versus if we constrain them to using an electronic interface? And there are some questions about looking ahead. So what's on the horizon and what other uses of technology might we envisage being useful? And getting into things like AI. So, you know, is it possible to make our e-assessment systems more intelligent so that they can maybe that actually relates to the previous question of dealing with this more rich free-form input. Okay, and then on to the final group of questions, which are about mathematical skills. So this is sort of reflected in the fact that our agenda really is for e-assessment in mathematics. There are some particular skills that we're interested in developing in mathematics. And the questions here are broadly on the theme of how can we use e-assessment to support students to develop those skills? So we have groups of questions about problem solving and about proof. And again, these relate to some of the things I was talking about in the previous theme to do with free-form input. So being able to assess a whole proof, is that something that we can do? Or are there ways that we can assess some of the skills that build up to being able to write a free-form proof? And then there's also a group of questions around example generation. So that's a strength of e-assessment. It's often held up as a strength of e-assessment that we can take a student's generated example of something, you know, quadratic with two given roots. They've been asked to write in a quadratic, and we can test if it has the desired properties. But that kind of question is not often used actually these days. But are there ways to, maybe it comes back to the guidance for lecturers and task developers, are there ways to make these kinds of tasks more effective and easier to implement? But also, what effect does it have on students' learning? And is there a difference between doing these kinds of tasks on paper and online? So hopefully you're seeing that these questions are not necessarily easy to disentangle, and they relate across the themes as well. So on that point, I was playing a bit at the weekend with our list of questions. And for each question, we do make connections to other questions in the agenda. So what this is a graph of all those links between questions, where you can see there's an edge between two of the nodes. So the nodes represent the questions, and we put an edge between them if there's one question refers to the other. And so that's where those themes land. I should say this is still a bit of a work in progress. So there are some nodes there that you can see are disconnected, and I think that will probably end up not being the case, because I found, as I was over the past few weeks looking more closely at some of these questions and having this layout of the different themes, as I got more and more familiar with the whole agenda, I was seeing more and more of these connections between the questions as well. So I suspect that this is there are many more edges to be added to this graph. That's kind of my point. okay, so that's the agenda as it stands. We've got 55 questions. What are we going to be doing with all of this? So there's two outputs that I was mentioning at the start. So first of all, the manuscript, which will explain the method that we've used, make sure that we've documented all of that. And what we're going to do is for each of the themes, so they contain 10 to a dozen questions each, but we've split them up into sub-themes as well. So those are, you know, 2, 3, 4 questions that are all quite closely related. And we're going to present each of those with a bit of narrative. So here's an example for the example generation question group. So we present the questions as they appear in the agenda, and then we've got two or three paragraphs where we try to summarize what those questions are about and how they connect to existing literature. But as I was saying, that that doesn't really do all the questions justice, and there's a lot more detail that we wanted to capture. So the second output is the website, where we'll have full details for each of the questions. So to pick one of those, just to give you an example of what it looks like, we have the question, we have the list of contributors who have said something towards fleshing out that question. And then we have a sort of consistent structure for each of the questions, where we ask what motivates the question. So that links it into existing literature, what is known about it, why is this something that we want to know the answer to. Then we have a section on what might an answer look like. So that's where often there's a suggestion of maybe an experimental approach that could be used to try and answer this question, or it's pointing out maybe some of the things that you would need to consider if you were going to be coming up with an answer. You know, what does it mean to make something better? It'll try and add a bit more clarity to that. And then, yeah, so what I used to produce the graph that I showed you a minute ago, we relate that question to other ones in the agenda and give links to those. And finally, a reference list as well. So we're building up now actually quite an extensive reference list of things that would be useful. If you wanted to find an answer to this question, then here are some places to start in the existing literature. So I would have liked to have said, here's the link and go off and have a read, but we're not quite ready yet. Maybe by the end of the conference, we might have a version ready to share. Yeah, we'll see. I might post something on the EAMS course page. But if you are interested in finding out more about it, please drop me an email and I'll make sure to keep you updated with how we get on. I'd just like to end with thanking you all for attending and hearing about this. Particular thanks to people who were involved last year at EAMS and giving us input, and to the others who were involved in putting this all together. So thank you.